Mr. Olsen, who is a Pole, Swedish folk song called Great the Art.
Thank you. Let us pray the prayer of confession. We confess that we are imperfect people, Lord. We are stubborn and prefer to take the easy way out, rather than the challenging one that requires our trust in you. We look to ourselves and the world for comfort, and are then disappointed in what we find. We spend our time struggling to understand the world, instead of looking to you for answers. Forgive us, Lord, we pray.
His name is
Robert. I would like to bring up a joy. My daughter's friend had a baby boy, and that's Daniel and Adam, and he was born last Tuesday.
Yeah, I have something to share also. I want to lift up the family of Ron's friend, Duncan Cleary, who died at some point this past week. We don't have any details, but was a really good and longtime friend of Ron. So peace and comfort to all who are missing him today.
My friend Rosemary worries a lot, and she's now worried about her son, Gabriel, who he's a young man, probably in his 30s. And he's been diagnosed with high blood pressure, and he was hospitalized for that. So just prayers that he does what the doctors say and takes care of himself. Are there any others? Gail?
Lincoln, he's doing good. He's 2 pounds now. He's still having trouble with his breathing. He's 2 pounds.
Wow. And his name is?
Nikki.
Nikki?
Lincoln.
Lincoln. Oh.
Sorry, one other. A neighbor in our neighborhood that we know, Wally, is looking for answers, has been suffering now for weeks with weakness in his legs, and they're not sure what the cause of it is, but he's getting worse, and so they're looking for answers in that path forward, Wally.
Also, I did talk to May over the weekend. She expected to be home this weekend and maybe in church, but traveling mercies for May and her family guiding her up. She has a cat with her, so they're driving.
The cat driving?
Yes.
And Arlene?
Yes.
Also for Marta, who is our daughter-in-law's grandmother. She's, I believe, 92 and has COVID. Living in Guatemala. Arlene, there was 4, right, that we had to? 4 prayer concerns we had. We had Wally, Marta. I don't know that Duncan's family was one.
Yeah.
Oh, well. Well, I'll think about it.
Let us pray. Lord God, your family has gathered together today in communion and fellowship. Our prayers are always heard by you, and your loving compassion for us is never changing. Help us to trust in your plans for us. When families gather together and enjoy a meal and fellowship, the conversations turn to those persons in our lives for whom we seek peace and celebration of life's events. Our personal prayers are not to be neglected, as they bring us individually closer to you, Lord. Praying as a church family brings us closer to each other and to you, Lord. Hear us again this day as we lift up the joys and concerns in the congregation of your people. Father, even though we can rest knowing you never withhold your love from us, there are those who are in need of your healing touch. Let them be assured that you, Lord, are going through this with them. They are not alone. Rosemary, Gabriel, dealing with high blood pressure and worry. Duncan, the Cleary family, as Duncan has passed away. And Wally, looking for health issues. And also Marta in Guatemala. Father, it is the little things that bring us joy today. We celebrate with Danielle and Adam as they welcome a baby boy into their family. And Robert has had good news about testing in the hospital. And Dale's Lincoln is gaining weight. We also pray for the traveling mercies for May and her cat. The world, Lord, we live in a beautiful and complex world. Where there is conflict, bring peace. Calm the forces of nature that threaten your people. Forgive those who don't understand that you are the one who can lead them to peace. Come into their hearts. Create understanding where there is discord and create order where there is chaos. Lord God, you sent us an advocate, One who heard the cries of those who called out to you for peace, for comfort and freedom from oppression. We are still in need of the same things in the world today. Your son heard them, and now you hear us. Father God, when they asked Jesus how we should pray, he taught them the prayer that we, with one voice, pray to you today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Over and over again, nothing works no matter how hard you try,
or maybe you don't have what you need, or it keeps breaking, or you keep falling down, you keep getting delayed, no matter how hard you try, you just can't accomplish what it is in your dream you're supposed to be doing. It's like trying to run through a pit of molasses. Have you ever had one of those dreams? I know I have. I usually dream those kinds of dreams when I'm feeling really uncertain about something, or maybe it's something that I'm trying for the first time and I'm not thoroughly comfortable with it yet. How about in real life? Have you ever had that experience in your real, actual life?
I think everybody.
Yeah, yeah, probably everybody has, right? I know, again, I know I have. You know, some idea that you think is what you're supposed to be doing that you try to make work, and no matter how hard you try to make it work in your real, actual life, nothing happens, nothing comes of it. Something that you're trying to accomplish, but no matter how hard you try, it just doesn't come to pass. A few years ago, this happened to me in my real, actual life. I had made a plan in my mind to get out of ministry. I was going to go and work with the elderly in a nursing home. That was what my plan was. And I had the skills and I had the experience from working in the church and working with a lot of children throughout the years that made it seem to be a good fit for me. But no matter how many applications I submitted, or how hard I tried, how long I spent on LinkedIn trying to make contacts with people, no matter how many people we actually knew that I reached out to personally, no matter how hard I tried to get into an activities department in any one of the dozens of nursing homes that exist, especially here in New Jersey, nothing happened, nothing. Dead silence, not a single inquiry, despite the many applications I filled out and the many job descriptions I seemed to fit, nothing. No matter how hard I tried to row my boat, that is my life, in that direction, I couldn't reach my destination. It felt an awful lot like rowing against the wind that we see our disciples doing this morning. And many hours and days and weeks later, I was still there in that boat, rowing in circles, rowing as hard as I could, and yet still completely far from my destination. And looking back on that time, I now realize that the destination I was trying to reach, the one I had in mind, wasn't actually the one where Jesus was leading me to go. So try as I might, with all of my best efforts, my boat just didn't move. That's because Jesus was busy trying to take me somewhere else, someplace he wanted me to go. And until I finally was willing to let him into the boat and steer, I would just remain stuck there rowing against the wind. You see, our best efforts and our best ideas and plans are no guarantee of God's blessing. And once I was willing to submit my will to God's will, immediately, no joke, immediately, I landed on the shore exactly where it was he wanted me to go. And in fact, I landed right here at this church. Because every single door to coming here was opened for me on my behalf without hardly any effort on my part at all. So I had this contrast of rowing against the wind and getting nowhere, or becoming the minister here at this church so easily. It was such a contrast. And in our reading from the Gospel of John this morning, Jesus' own disciples are experiencing this very thing. They just finished feeding the 5,000. 5,000 plus men, women, and children were fed with just 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. Seemingly effortlessly on their part. The crowds have now eaten their fill. There's still 12 basketfuls of fish and bread left over, all thanks to the miracle done by Jesus for the people in order that they might see and know and understand the power of God. Clearly, in this scene of feeding the 5,000, everyone is exactly where they should be, as Jesus provides miraculous food so that no one needs to leave, and in order that they can see, and they can hear, and they can taste, and they can touch, and they can feel, and they can believe all that Jesus has been teaching to them. And all of Jesus' teachings there on the mountainside point to a reversal of worldly powers. The meek will inherit the earth. The pure in heart are the ones who will see God. Peacemakers are called sons and daughters of God. And those who are persecuted in the world are the ones who receive the kingdom of God. Jesus' message there on the mountain is one of humility and submission. Nowhere in any of Jesus' teachings does he ever teach domination, war, violence, fighting. And yet if we were to read verses 14 and 15 of John's Gospel, we would read these words. After the people saw the miraculous sign that Jesus did, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who has come into the world." And Jesus, knowing that they intended to make him king by force, withdrew by himself. But John's Gospel also leaves out an important and telling part of the story, saying only, "When evening came, the disciples went down to the lake where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum. By now it was dark and Jesus had not yet joined them." How exactly do you suppose it is that they pictured Jesus joining them while they're rowing across the lake? It's an interesting question, isn't it? Now, if we were to read the account of the feeding of the 5,000 from Matthew or Mark's gospel, we would also read that before Jesus heads off to pray, and the disciples, according to John, go down to the lake and they get in the boat, Matthew and Mark's gospel say that immediately, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him. And then Jesus dismissed the crowds. Immediately, he made them get into the boat. You see, the disciples don't just get in the boat of their own accord, their own choosing. They are sent out into the water by Jesus. Why is this? With such a forceful and urgent scene of sending them off immediately, out on their own without him. Well, perhaps it's in order that they might struggle for a while at the oars. Maybe it's so that they can fight against the wind for a while. Perhaps the disciples need to spend some pent-up energy that they've somehow accumulated and learn some humility and gain some new perspective by rowing against the wind for a while. Perhaps, like the rest of the crowd, Jesus' disciples were also hoping to make him king by force. Might they, too, have gotten the wrong idea about who Jesus is? Perhaps they were caught up in the frenzy of the moment, just like all the rest there on the mountainside,
Might they, his own disciples, have been making their own plans and trying to take control of the situation, making plans to go somewhere that Jesus did not have planned for them, and envisioning Jesus as someone Jesus is not, a king, willing to lead an insurrection, willing to gather his followers and start up the rebellion that they have in mind? This might be the reason that Jesus so forcefully and immediately sends the disciples out into the water, into a boat without him. Go. Go struggle on the sea against the wind and the waves for a while without me. Perhaps a few hours of struggling at the oars and trying to arrive on the other shore without him is exactly what they need in order to get them back on track to where it is they should be going, in the direction of God's kingdom, where the meek inherit the earth and the peacemakers are called sons and daughters of God. Perhaps a few hours of fighting the wind and acknowledging their own powerlessness will make them ready to surrender their own agendas and let Jesus into the boat to lead them once again. Because that's exactly the word that the scriptures use. It says, then they were willing to let him into the boat. Our lives can feel a lot like being in a boat, surrounded by others who are also trying to figure out where they're going and how best they should get there. There are times when we do nothing but seem to struggle against the wind of God getting us nowhere. But when we surrender our agendas to God's agenda, and when we become willing to let Jesus into our boats, then we discover where it is God is trying to take us. Then we stop rowing in circles and stop struggling with the oars. At such times, we can try all we want to make something happen by our own power. Even sometimes these are good things that we have in mind. But unless we align ourselves with God's plan for us, then we just struggle in vain. It's like having the anxiety dream where no matter how hard you try, nothing seems to work. It can be frustrating. At times it can be somewhat terrifying. Until we let Jesus show us the way. The Son of God incarnate, who is the way. He came into the world in order to show us and lead us to the way, calming our greatest fear, quieting the storms that rage within us. Surrendering our lives to God by letting Jesus into the boat sends us off in the direction that God intends for our lives and ensures then that we land on the other side exactly where God intends for us to be. Because with Jesus, there's no reason to keep on struggling. There's no reason to keep fighting against the wind, because all the while Jesus has been willing to get in the boat with us. Letting Jesus into the boat to direct our journey is the first step towards seeing miracles. Because there is no sea, no ocean greater than the love of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who can do immeasurably more than all we could ever ask or imagine. Would you pray with me? Lord, you are the captain of our lives. You show us the way and bring us safely to shore. Lord, be with us always. Help us to learn the lessons that you are trying to teach us as you lead us ever onward, no longer trying to find our way alone. Give us hearts of humility that are willing to surrender and let go of control and allow you into the boat that is our lives, where we begin to see the world in miraculous new ways whenever we surrender our will to your will. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing our next hymn, number 422, our response to God's grace, by singing 422, Amazing Grace.
Amen.
bulletins. Go forth to live boldly, as if death has no power over you. Live as if your lives count for something, because they do. May the mercy of God grant us, the love of Christ take root in us, the Holy Spirit grow us, that we may recognize the coming of God's kingdom.